Hey everyone, Dr. Nick Delgado here. I want to comment about a video reply with Joe Rogan's show. Do vegans get the amino acids they need? Game changer debate. Really important to hear this because I think there's more confusion about protein than any other subject. And I do believe that once that confusion is corrected, more people can become incredibly healthy. The big holdup is people think they have to have more protein to be healthy. And I wrote about in the year 2000, Grow Young and Slim, in the chapter 11, page 201, I went through the entire history and information about protein requirements and what people need and how you and I had been misled about protein requirements. Nan Bronfen wrote a really good book, and it's called Nutrition for a Better Life, and she was the nutritionist for the Pritikin Research Foundation. And for athletes, P.O. Astrand, the textbook of work of physiology, and that documents the incredible findings, how people can perform at very high levels with sufficient plant-based proteins. If you choose to add animal proteins to your diet, so be it. But it's not necessary. We do believe you need vitamin B12. We need some rich source of omegas, which I use soaked nut seeds and walnuts. And I do believe that some who don't get enough daylight outdoors could benefit from vitamin D3. And also, if you're into anti-aging and the pursuit of longevity, it's important to understand all the different herbs that support healthy hormone metabolism, particularly because I wrote the book, Acne Be Gone for Good, and that book explains how we are exposed to massive levels of what's called estrogen dominance. Estrogen dominance is toxic, it's deadly, it's dangerous. Not only does it mar our kids' skin, 80% of young people at some time during their life will develop acne and continue to have adult acne. This is been proven in many cases to be related to excessive levels of hormonal exposure, principally coming from animal product. I know there's a guy out there, Dr. Shaw, saying that he's a carnivore and you can eat all meat and he doesn't have to take steroids and he's all buffed and built up. Well, of course, animals have a lot of steroid influence, not just the testosterone. They're loaded with estrogen, whether it be pig, cow, lamb, chicken, they're all loaded with estrogen because they have estrous cycles, hormonal cycles, and you're eating their hormones. Let's jump into the debate because we do know that plants have essential amino acids, and the mistaken belief is that we have to have 8 essential amino acids based on an animal model, namely rats. And rats grow to full size. Osborne and Mendel showed that they grow to full size, say, in several weeks. So they were able to test those animals, and they gave them individual foods like potatoes only, and they measured the growth rate of the rats. Then they gave them meat only or eggs only. And they found that in their study of rats, that eggs had the sufficient protein, which is very close to rat's breast milk, to reach full size. However, when studies were published in the Journal of Clinical Nutrition, I cite those exact studies, and you can find out for a fact that when individuals, rats in particular, are given wheat only or potatoes only, they don't grow very well. But if you add what's called the limiting amino acid lysine in that case, the rats will grow to full size. However, that does not prove that that is the ideal protein for humans. In fact, human breast milk is less than 6% protein. In fact, when you give human breast milk to rats, they don't grow very well. So, and this is cited quite well in the medical journals. There's also the Southern Medical Journal, 1987, on 775 pure vegan women, totally meat-free, dairy-free. The babies grew to full term. There was no complications. They were healthy. And all of this as we look at the confusion started about because of Frances Moore LePay wrote a book, Diet for a Small Planet, and she said that you have to combine beans and rice to get a complete protein for the amino acid pattern. But later, her 10-year revised edition, she recounted that quote and said, I was wrong. I misled people. In fact, all the essential amino acids are in rice by itself or beans by itself, so long as you get sufficient calories and you're not an alcoholic. Okay, so keep in mind the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, volume 27, page 1231, 1974, where they did the rat studies, and in those studies, we're able to identify that rats have a much different protein requirement, particularly amino acid requirement, and that's where all the confusion started out. This was published in my original book, Growing and Slim. You can still get the book on Amazon or contact our office. I'm sure we have some copies we could ship to you. And I want to jump into this debate because Joe Rogan has a huge audience. I'd love him to have me come on the show. And by the way, if you see me contracting, it's because I have some electrodes on, and it's causing very strong contractions while I'm on the show, getting incredible, as if I did 500 push-ups, 500 sit-ups, and I'm working my hamstrings right now too. So I move the electrodes from the Tesla Max every 45 minutes, and it shoots through right now about 200 and 300 volts of energy going through, causing very strong contractions. And about every 3 minutes, I turn the voltage up because sometimes I'm at a computer for hours and I don't get a chance to get out to get in my routine until later. So I like to work out outdoors in the sun and have a great workout, breathing heavily. And I do that at least 4 days a week over the last 20 years when I'm training to compete in dumbbell press and lift. Oftentimes I'm training 6 or 7 days a week. So do I get enough protein as an elite athlete? Absolutely. Can I build a muscular body? Absolutely. And how does that happen? For 40 years on a plant-based, oil-free, whole foods diet. Do I occasionally eat some organ meat or animal meat or organs in like thyroid preparation or adrenal? Yes. And it's essentially that's for thyroid or hormonal balance. I choose to do that based on my laboratory work. Do I need the added animal protein to build muscle? Absolutely not. In fact, my best muscle gains are when I'm completely plant-based. And this was proven by Dr. Lee, who took young 22-year-olds, measured their nitrogen retention, giving them cheap white rice. That's right, only white rice. They measured their amino acid balance, and it was full nitrogen absorption. They then gave them rice and chicken, and to their shock, the addition of chicken reduced their amino acid absorption by 20%. It was 20% worse when they added chicken. So something about animal product, particularly chicken, does not absorb very well for humans, where it does work quite well for rats. So now let's jump into this conversation with one of the individuals who is on The Game Changer, and you can see that on Netflix. I really highly suggest you watch it, where Arnold Schwarzenegger comes out and talks about how he's gone plant-based. Probably he's, according to my interview recording of him last year at the Arnold Classic, I'm going to see him again this year in March. He's about, in his words, about 80% plant-based, about 20% animal-based, and it's just because it's convenient. I don't sincerely believe he thinks he has to add animal product at all to his diet to build muscle. He even says it's unnecessary to add meat. James Cameron has been his coach and mentor, who was the producer of The Terminator and some other famous movies, Avatar, and he is complete plant-based. That is James Cameron. So let's jump into this debate. I think you'll find it quite entertaining and interesting, and then we'll conclude. If you have any questions, please jump on. I'll do my best to try and answer them during the course of the show instead of typing them out, because in the past, when I've typed them out, it's not very easy for me to keep up with that. Okay, so here, let's see if I can find videos. Okay, give me a minute here so I can watch your questions on my screen here. Okay, I think this will work. Okay, it says live. Okay, here we go. Okay, let's watch this debate, and I think you'll find it pretty lively. I believe it's James Wilkes and his counterpart there who's attacking his position. Here, let's see if he states his name at the beginning. I don't see it, but here, we'll jump in on the conversation.
Again, apologize for people just listening.
But research focusing on protein malnutrition was largely conducted after the identification of
kwashiorkor,
and the realization that many children globally are suffering from subclinical protein malnutrition. To address protein malnutrition, the composition and digestibility of proteins must be determined.
Okay, so if you go to the next slide, and this is, by the way, that was looking at the DS score. You know, you can see at the top, can the DIS score decrease protein malnutrition? Then they go on to say, Joe, do you want to do it?
The Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations has developed methods to evaluate the protein quality of food items. And in 2011, the Digestible Indispensable Amino Acid Score, DIAAS, was recommended as a successor to the previous method.
Okay, so we're not in a disagreement right now. No. I'm even going to forego, like, I'm not going to argue about the animal having different amino acid requirements, even though that's, like, that's pretty funny, right? Like, why are you assessing? Anyway, so I'm not going to have that argument. Okay. What I'm going to have is I'm going to go with.
I think he should have had that argument because the amino acid pattern has been proven in the medical literature. It's completely different for rats, which is the test subject that all nutrition college textbooks sponsored by who? The meat and dairy industry and egg board, who sponsors these textbooks so that students can learn, quote, proper nutrition based on the four food groups, which forces us to believe as a young person when we're growing up and in college, when we read the nutrition books, that we have to have animal product to get a complete protein. But okay, let's go down their argument line, and you'll see how he easily dispels these myths about how much protein you need and that plant protein is indeed not only appropriate, I'll tell you it's superior. You can take an elite athlete, put them in similar situations using similar hormonal intervention, whether it be anabolic or if they're using bioidentical hormone. You can put them on similar training programs, provided they have similar genetics. Some of the top world-class athletes I've cited in my book and in my new revision of the book, Growing and Slim, and of course in The Game Changer, we talk about this as well, and in my own experience. So let's take a look here. 40 years I've been plant-based, oil-free, vegan, and eating, if you will, an occasional small serving of animal product at maybe a social get-together here and there. Since I'm not, quote, an ethical vegetarian, vegan, I am a plant-based, whole food eating individual for health. And so let's talk about Nutritarian and Joel Fuhrman and John McDougall and Nathan Pritikin and all the great predecessors that have contributed to this information. But let's hear their debate.
Everything so far, FAO, they're endorsing it over the PDS, a lot of experts endorsing it over the DIAS,
okay.
Over the PDCAS.
Okay.
Right? So now in slide 31, it's made for starving children, okay?
Mm-hmm.
This is what it's made for. So I would agree, if you're in a caloric deficit and you're in a country where there's very little protein and you're only getting 30 grams of protein a day, let's just say that the animal, like take the animal stuff out of it and like the way that the method is flawed,
okay.
Which the FAO points out.
Yes.
But let's just say it's legit. I would agree. I would say eat, get your protein from meat. I would agree, because that's what it was designed for. As you can see, in looking at post-exercise skeletal muscle, the DIAS does not attempt to consider how scores translate into optimizing more downstream physiological targets of interest to a physically active person or athlete. So it wasn't designed for that system. It was designed for starving people in countries where they were not getting enough protein, and they weren't getting enough protein, as you would call, high quality, okay? So would you recognize that it wasn't developed for that system?
Yes.
Okay. Based on the scientific literature. But you're inferring it now for the amount that...
I still think it's a relevant measure of protein quality because it looks at amino acid profile and ileal digestibility.
Yeah, it is. It is in starving countries when people are starving. I agree. But as you can see,
It's still looking at amino acid profile, right? Do you concede that? It's looking at the relative content of amino acids in a particular food.
Yes.
And it's looking at the ileal digestibility.
Which I think is an improvement. I think it's got elements, even though the FAOs point out its flaws, and 10 years from now we'll have a better system, right? But, right, you agree, probably 10 years from now we'll probably have a better system.
I would imagine.
Okay, but it's the best that it can kind of go of, but again, it looks at, and it's not just my opinion that it's not used for that. This is like, in sports medicine, 2019, and I agree, you're busy with other stuff, you probably haven't seen this article that came out in February. Right, have you seen this article before?
I have not seen this particular article.
So basically, can you look at in the 2008?
Okay, so he's James Wilkes is debating this guy. I believe his name is Chris, and there was a prior debate on Joe Rogan's show, and so James Wilkes has come back to counter arguments, which you'll see he easily prevails in this debate with the course of the prevailing amount of science. I do have a question from the audience here. And he's asking, vegans dealing with excessive gas, usually beans and potatoes. First off, when I cook beans, it's ideal if you soak them overnight. I like to cook them in a slow-cooking crock pot to get the greatest amount of vitamins, minerals, nutrition, fiber, but break down the elements of beans that tend to cause gas. But if you soak the beans and then you pour off the fluid, a lot of the gas-producing properties are within that. And if beans are also pressure-cooked, that helps. In fact, Rosarita canned beans, non-fat available, is pressure-cooked and done in a manner that causes very little gas. Of course, some people will have concern about the type of cans that, you know, any kind of canned food comes in. But I will say this, that you're going to initially, the reason you have gas is because people on an animal-based diet have this horrible type of bacteria called anaerobic bacteria that lives without oxygen, according to Dr. Dennis Burkett. And when you're taking in this additional high fiber, along with potatoes or yams, sweet potatoes and so forth, and various vegetables, fruit, and all the good foods, nuts and seeds with their fiber intact, the good bacteria, the aerobic bacteria that lives with oxygen, will take its place. And so during that first week or two or three, there's going to be more gas, but that's a good thing. You're getting rid of massive toxins in the body. Sure, go for a jog, go for a walk, let go of the gas to be socially polite, right? But I had a very famous anti-aging doctor, head of one of the big worldhealth.net, and he came up to me and says, you know, your diet's great, but I got a problem. I got to use the restroom all the time. Yeah, with all that fiber, all the toxins in your body, you're passing through 2 to 4 times per day is common for a healthy bowel movements and removing toxins. Would you want the trash to build up in your house and not get rid of it on a weekly basis with the trash man coming by and taking out the cans? Well, most people only have a bowel movement once a day, or maybe even a stream twice a week. All those toxins have been associated with a higher rate of colon cancer, digestive disorders, hiatal hernias, varicose veins. So anyone on a keto diet never gets enough fiber, hardly ever. It's nearly impossible, because primitive man had a need for about 60 to 100 to 120 grams of fiber a day. In fact, there's a study of women who were at risk for breast cancer, and they gave them an assurance of 120 grams of fiber a day. And what they reported in the outcome of the study, that the severe toxic deoxycholic acid in the colon that's associated with colon cancer, the levels of hormones associated with breast cancer were reduced significantly to safer levels. But they also reported the largest recorded stools and the most frequent 4 times a day. And they called these women, who became very healthy at much lower risk of breast cancer, the super poopers. So keep in mind that, yes, it's a biological fact. When you're on a high fiber, high plant-based diet, oil-free, there's less requirements for water because you're eating more fruit too, which fruit's high in water. So you're going to use the pass urine more often. But it's clear urine. It's free of toxins per se, because the urine, if it's running yellow, you're highly dehydrated and you're really excreting byproducts of protein metabolism. Almost everyone on a high protein keto diet has a lot of toxic urine. It smells, it's yellow in color or darker. And except when we do put people on estroblock, which helps to get rid of estrogen dominance, the urine, because of all the toxic estrogen chemicals and pesticides and xenoestrogens and the meat byproducts of estrogen, it turns like a bright, almost dark orange for at least several days. So don't be surprised if you see that. So, okay, let's go back in this debate. Thanks for the questions. Keep them flowing because we're live right now and I'm coming to you here. And it's so exciting to share with you this information. Once again, the purpose is to educate and to guide you so that you get the right information here, and we'll rebroadcast this as well for those of you who want to hear the truth about how much protein you require and how much does athletes require. Let's see what they go on to say here at the Joe Rogan Show with James Wilkes, the guest.
2018 Journal of International Sports of Sports Nutrition, slide 32, Society of Sports Nutrition. Because you like to say it's all about muscle protein synthesis, right?
That's an important factor.
Okay.
It has been proposed that muscle protein synthesis is maximized in young adults with an intake of 20 to 25 grams of high-quality protein.
About
20 to 25 grams of a high-quality protein.
Okay, high-quality protein. Okay. Do you disagree that, like, eating four or five times a day at 20 to 25 grams of high quality protein, whatever you want to take, highest score, whatever, under your, you know, the scoring system you agree with. Do you agree that that is the amount to maximize muscle protein when it shows that that does for a 4-hour window acute muscle protein synthesis?
Yeah, the most of the sports organizations suggest that for acute protein intake.
But if you, I'm going with the consensus. So if you take that 20 to 25 grams four or five times a day, multiply that. What is that? That's 80 to 100, about 100, 120 grams of protein a day. Is that enough for a big athlete?
Or muscle protein synthesis.
Right, is that enough for like a 250-pound athlete? I would say no. So I'm not saying that it is. I think you need more protein than that, right?
So acute muscle protein synthesis is only one factor.
Right, can you tell me what the other factors are?
Tissue regeneration and repair, recovery.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think we're on the same page that 20 to 25 grams has basically been shown in a single sitting over a 4-hour window in what they call acute, short term. That's been shown to maximize muscle protein synthesis. And that is because 20 grams, and it's been shown actually you can get less with like egg, you could get like 17 grams or something. But it's basically you're hitting two things. You're hitting leucine, you're getting 1.8 to 2 grams of leucine, which is basically like a foreman. Right, it's like telling the others, like, hey, you should build protein. If you don't have any leucine, and if you had all the essential amino acids you want except for leucine, you wouldn't have the foreman telling all the workers to like build the muscle. Basically, that's what leucine is. So you're getting enough leucine, and you're getting 8 to 10 grams of essential amino acids. That is what is important in the acute stage of muscle protein synthesis. You're getting 8 to 10 grams of, and we can get more granular down, like it's, you know, 0.0 grams per pound of body weight. But this is basically accepted. And in fact, they've shown that, like, even if you're 400 pounds, you know, you probably don't need even more than 20, 25 grams. For some reason, there's something in that number about getting the leucine amount. It doesn't really matter how big you are. So, you know, there's a small percentage of people that say you might need a bit more, 2.5 or whatever. But consensus is this 20, 25 grams. And so,
okay, so they're discussing then how many grams of protein with the amino acid leucine. Now, you have to be careful of this information because leucine has now been implicated in a higher risk of increase in mTOR, mammalian targeted on rapamycin, and that is associated with a higher increased risk of cancer, some other problems of shortening of lifespan, whereas plants, fruits, vegetables, beans, and peas, particularly fruits and vegetables, are much lower in leucine, but you get all the leucine you need, even by eating enough calories to meet your caloric needs. It's estimated that on a plant-based whole foods diet, you're getting at least 80 grams of quality protein, eaten 3 or 4 times a day in meals, and that is more than double the nutritional requirements for protein for anyone, even elite athletes. I spoke with Brendan Mebane, a 300-pound lineman for the LA Chargers, and I interviewed him last year on my podcast. And listen to that interview. But he basically talks about how he's gone plant-based out of concern, family members having a risk of breast cancer and so forth. And you know, he's performing amongst his best. So, you know, athletes, including the Tennessee Titans, I'm told 14 of the linemen and running backs are now on a plant-based whole foods diet. So keep in mind, healthy eating is absolutely essential, but you get all the protein you need on a plant-based whole foods diet.
Sorry, this is like long, but it's like it's important to like break down. Okay. So by the way, just going back to your DS scoring, you're basically looking at like a rules for a jiu-jitsu tournament, like a gi jiu-jitsu tournament, and you're trying to apply them to MMA. So just because jiu-jitsu is involved in MMA, it doesn't mean that it can't be, because you wouldn't be hitting the 1.6 to 2.2. Yep. So this states, acute anabolic responses are not necessarily associated with long-term muscular gains. The topic can only be answered by assessing the results of longitudinal studies that directly measure changes in lean mass with the provision of varying protein dosages. Okay, so you agree that it's not just about short-term muscle bulkiness. Okay, so what it is, Joe, it doesn't matter. At a certain point, it doesn't matter because, yeah, if let's say you're going to have 4 times a day, and let's say you're going to have 160 grams of protein, and you have 40 grams, right, mm-hmm. of protein 4 times a day, that's 160 grams.
Hi, Roman.
So if you're going to optimize muscle mass, and by the way, like how much muscle have you put on in the last 15 years?
No, I'm not sure.
Well, me, I'm like, I put on none, right, basically. I'm about the same. Right. Like, but anyway, let's just say that you're a bodybuilder and you're trying to stack on as much muscle as possible. Because that's like, even like when I get like, I'm like 190, 193 maybe sometimes. Like, if I go over 200, I just feel slow. I feel slow with the handgun. I feel slower punching, like whatever. So it's not everyone's goal is to optimize muscle mass as quickly as possible, right? But let's say that your goal is, right? Clearly, it's not enough to do that. You have to hit the 1.6 to 2.2 grams. Right?
Right.
Once you hit that amount, you have to do two things. You have to hit the muscle, the short-term leucine threshold and amino acid in the short term, right? And then you have to hit the...
What are you doing, Jim?
It was an honest, my bad. So what you have to do two things. You have to maximize the muscle protein synthesis in the short term, and you have to get enough protein during the day, right? Of 1.6 to 2.2. Is that fair? Okay. So once you hit the 1.6 to 2.2, let's say you have 40 grams, it doesn't matter. You follow me? You even quoted...
So it doesn't matter the amino acid profile of the food? Is that what you're saying?
No, because as long as you hit the essential amino acid amount and the leucine amount in the four...
And you can hit the leucine amount and the amino acid amount in virtually all of these vegan forms of protein? Is that what you're saying?
No. No, if you're having, like, first of all, you could do it with, like, if you do beans, rice, and vegetables, yeah, you'd hit 2 grams of protein for, like, 570 calories. Now, again, you could, like, you know that most athletes supplement, right?
Yes.
Like, I can have got slides if you want for scientific proof, but you...
Okay, so what James Wilkes is saying is that eating beans, rice, and vegetables will give you all the protein you need, which is true. And you probably couldn't get enough protein if you ate only celery sticks all day long or some kind of a weird fad diet of grapefruit and celery sticks. Because the calories are so low, whatever calories are used are going to be used for energy requirements. But what they're forgetting is the body uses protein to create enzymes. Enzymes are critical for life. Without enzymes, for example, you couldn't even digest a meal of protein. It would take 50 years to digest one meal of protein. So enzymes are absolutely essential to accelerate chemical reactions in the body to produce muscle, strength, energy, well-being. And so that being said, the body produces and recycles 150 grams of enzymes, protein, highest pure quality protein known in the body, recycles And because enzymes are so important, you can't be without. And also the digestive tract, we slough off 30 grams of protein per day that recycles. And so you get a 180 grams of protein a day. They haven't even brought that up in this discussion. And so the foods that you get, according to Dr. Kempner, kept his people over a one-year period who were wanting to lose weight, protect their kidneys. They had to go on a lower protein intake, and they had diabetes, that the individuals were free of diabetes. They met their protein needs. They saved their kidneys. And the average person lost 147 pounds during the course of a year while on only 20 grams of protein a day from rice and fruit. 20 grams of protein met all their protein nitrogen requirements. There was no protein deficiency, no side effects, no issue. So keep in mind, I'm not advocating that you eat only rice and fruit. I'm saying a big variety of beans, peas, fruits, vegetables, nuts, seeds, avocados, olives, whole foods to meet your caloric needs based on your exercise demands. But an athlete, an elite athlete, you can build massive muscle, but that's dependent on genetics. Think of Arnold with his incredible chest and genetics, or Larry Scott, if you follow Mr. Olympiad, his incredible biceps. Think of any of the top guys had the best genetics, but they all admitted to using anabolic steroids, every one of them. There are natural athletes, of course, and they have superb genetics. Rose Cordosa, she is someone I'm working with and sponsoring, has never needed anabolic steroids, and she has phenomenal physique, much like Sergio Oliva, the Cuban bodybuilder, had incredible genetics. And then you add intense training, frequent getting enough rest. The protein requirements are easily met from a whole plant-based foods diet and easier to reach your goal weight. In fact, that's why Lee Haney won, I believe it was 8 Mr. Olympiads on 500 grams of complex carbohydrate foods to spare his energy protein for protein needs. Yeah, you use glucose first before you use protein as an energy need. And protein is a very poor source of energy, according to P.O. Astran. And if you read through this entire textbook, when they compared animal protein to starch complex carbohydrates to, you know, from fruits and vegetables and pancakes and potatoes, and also you compare that to fat and fatty acids, he found that the higher 80% complex carbohydrate, the lower fat, 10% fat, 10% protein, gave the best performance for elite athletes when measured on bicycle ergometer compared to high protein diet, compared to high fat diet. So keep in mind then, this whole argument or debate about protein, I have one of the best talks I did with Dr. John McDougall at his weekend event. And if you look it up on YouTube, the current one is titled The Myths About Protein Requirements on my YouTube channel. Please subscribe if you haven't already. But let's go a little bit further.
You would accept that, like, an elite athlete's even more. So it's like over percent. For so sure. People are supplementing with protein powder anyway. Mm-hmm. They're supplementing with branched-chain amino acids because it contains leucine, isoleucine.
Elite athletes are, yes.
Well, no, over 50% are supplementing with protein powder, and a higher percentage
athletes,
of elites.
Just athletes, period.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Now, one of the reasons these athletes are supplementing with protein powders, as he pointed out, it offers some certain amino acids that have been shown to improve muscle growth and recovery. I created a plant-based whole food protein that is the Slim Blend protein, and it's 20 organic whole foods, it's non-GMO, it's using a plant-based high-quality combination that's free of grains, and most athletes, when they find out about this, they're ecstatic, because this is easy if they're going to supplement dairy whey, which we always say, no whey to whey, not good for you. Do not use the egg proteins, the animal proteins. That was all based on rat studies. Rats grow bigger with those kind of proteins, but humans grow better with plant-based proteins, and the evidence is becoming in more substantial. So James Wilkes is a little bit off on some of his argument, but it's okay. Let's continue, because he at least is saying that to equalize matters, elite athletes do supplement to make sure they get enough protein and not just depend on a plant-based whole foods diet. But let's go further.
High elite athletes are supplementing even more.
It's probably more like 90.
So like, if your goal is to like do something and like take creatine or you know, a protein, or like, you know, these athletic endeavors, like you pointed out, the thing that Patrick does And we can get into, by the way, the misrepresentation of from Robert Obhurst into his, Patrick's records, if you want, because there was a lot of claims that were made that were completely false again. So basically, if you get enough protein, if you hit one of the windows, if you hit the 1.6 to 2.2 with plant protein, you can hit the muscle protein synthesis. And like, all of a sudden, he's like, oh,
so you're saying there's no benefit in animal protein for an amino acid profile versus plant protein?
No, I'm not. If you're getting enough protein.
So you're saying if you're getting enough protein,
for, and we're
there's
talking about
no benefit. Here.
Okay. I'm even talking about
the hoodie. But if athletes,
and you're getting the right ratio of, as you have acknowledged, of the right ratio of plant proteins.
No. It's not difficult at all. Like, I'm talking about leucine. If you were really messing up and eating, like, people just don't eat healthy, you mm-hmm. might not get enough leucine. But like, if you're planning to become as big and as strong as possible, and you're dedicated, do you need a specific workout plan?
So, but this is only assuming that you're taking supplements. So we're assuming everyone's taking supplements achieve.
No.
I'm saying not
that,
at all.
No. You can do it with supplements.
Okay, and I'm not. But like, you're not, I'm not assuming that people are taking supplements.
No, you can do it.
But are you assuming that people are taking supplements?
No.
You can, these guidelines.
Okay, you can do it on a whole food diet, plant-based diet, with
just food.
With B12. Like, right?
Just supplement B12, nothing else. You can achieve the same amino acid profile as meat.
Yeah, I mean, I want to touch on that. I'm not saying that the only
thing. But that is the argument, right? No.
Okay, good. So he's finally zeroing in on that you can get on a whole foods diet all the essential amino acids that are necessary to meet your caloric needs and your protein needs on a whole food plant-based diet without supplementing, even if you choose to. So let's just let Joe Rogan continue here.
That was what he said.
But I just want to throw people off. Like, depending on where you live, you might want to supplement with vitamin D based on not getting enough sun.
Sure.
I just want to throw out.
Everybody should do that anyway.
Anyway.
Particularly D3.
Okay, so what I'm saying is, as long as you get that amount of protein, and again, if you're eating, if you're exercising to optimally build muscle, you're exercising a fair bit, right?
Yes.
You're burning more calories, right?
Right.
So you eat more calories. And I don't know where my slide is.
We're deep into the woods here, and this is getting really confusing.
No, I know,
but the question was, this is what his assertion was, that the amino acid profile of meat is superior
than
the amino acid profile of plants.
It is in context. That is what it's pointing. It's important when you look at the FAO and the goals that they're doing to try and stop world hunger. It is not important in the Western world, number one, and not important if you're an athlete and hitting you're getting between 1.6 to 2.0 grams per kilogram.
So what you're saying is that as long as you're getting this 1.6 to 2.2 grams per kilogram of protein, whether it's lentils or peanut butter or that you have enough amino acids to achieve the desired results.
Yeah.
And it's essentially the exact same as if you're hitting that 2.2 grams.
If you're getting 2.2 grams, it doesn't matter. It's irrelevant.
Do you think that's true?
If you're getting 2.2 grams of protein and you're doing it, and you're not doing it in the way that you said, where you're not planning it and not making sure you're getting enough leucine, which is low.
Well, you wouldn't have to try. It's really unfair.
Leucine, you're saying, is low.
Yeah,
in
I would say leucine is lower. And I agree. Yeah.
But there's a certain quantity that you will achieve.
There's
if
a
you
plateau.
Get those 2.2.
So there's a plateau. So it doesn't matter once you've got that amount.
Right.
The other point that you had about protein quality is digestibility. So that's the last point that I want to address.
Okay.
How am I doing?
Good.
Okay, so slide 34, because you basically claim that, okay, even if there are enough amino acids, you can't digest it as well. Okay.
The more precise data collected so far in humans assessing real specific oral ileal nitrogen digestibility has shown that the differences in the digestibility between plant and animal protein sources are only a few percent, contrary to historical findings in rats or determinations using less precise methods in humans.
Okay, and just so you know, I understand that you haven't seen this, probably, because it just came out last month, published by Stanford. So I get that you haven't seen it. Now, I'll take this one step further. There's only at most like 2 or 3% different in digestibility of plant protein. And you know how it's assessed in the pigs? They give them raw food. So they give raw beans, raw grains. And you have said one of the reasons that it's less digestible is because of trypsin inhibitors.
Yeah.
What happens when you cook?
You definitely break them down.
Are you getting it? So When you heat food, the likelihood is, even though it hasn't been tested, we know that the digestibility is less in plants by a few percent. Only a few percent, not the 40% versus 100% that he was claiming last time. That's old science. I'm talking about current science, right? And there's only a few percent difference. And they imagine that not only if you heated it, that you would get equivalent, you might even get more because you're killing the trypsin inhibitors by heating it. So that...
Okay, so keep in mind, he's bringing up a great point, and that is that the animal studies, and pig is close to human physiology. When we did autopsies and dissections on pigs and humans and so forth, we could see the organs and the systems are very, very similar with a pig as they are to a human, much more so than other animals, with the exception of monkeys, which are incredibly close to humans. Bonobos monkeys, the closest being, I think it's a 98.6 genetic match to humans. But what he's making a point is that if they had cooked the beans and give it to the pigs or to humans, we absorb the nitrogen protein because the fiber itself, inhibits in the enzyme trypsin inhibits protein amino acid absorption. But more than that, you should never eat raw beans, by the way. And I know Dave Asprey talks about lectins, and the other guy, the plant paradox doctor, he talks about lectins and how harmful they are. We need a little bit of lectins to prevent cancer and so forth. There's some now evidence showing it's beneficial to the immune system to have a little bit of the pectins. But just cook them sufficiently. Like I said, what I usually do is I just put them in a crock pot and I cook them all night in the morning with garlic and cilantro and other onions and things, with mushrooms, with the beans. And by morning, overnight, usually I guess about 8 hours or so, the beans are cooked perfectly and they hardly cause any gas whatsoever, as one of the earlier respondents asked earlier about that. So let's jump back into the arguments and the discussion.
Whole nonsense about the quantity, you were wrong. The quality, the DI score was not designed for that. It doesn't matter when you get enough protein. So as long as you get enough protein, you're using measures for a organization that is looking at hunger. We're talking about if people have got enough. I agree. If you're in a developing country and you have very little diversity of plant foods and maybe not enough and there's some animals, you should be eating the animals. I agree. But that is not what it was designed for, and it doesn't matter. The amino acid profile doesn't matter, and the digestibility doesn't matter when you get enough protein.
Okay, so to put it very simply then, the whole idea of, shall we say, protein absorption, I think he did a good job in dispelling the myths about protein requirement, and that Joe Rogan, his guest, was pretty much put to rest on this subject, because humans require essential amino acids, vitamins, minerals, nutrition. We have a product called Grow Muscle Burn Fat, an incredible product that has amino acids that stimulate the release of growth hormone, that it has the plant nitrates that releases nitric oxide, which is essential for circulation, quality sleep, improved immune system, and to burn, build muscle. These amino acids have been shown to, as again, stimulate natural human growth hormone levels and IGF. If you talk to Dr. Terry Hertog, he'll show you that most of the world studies show that IGF is beneficial to longevity and building muscle. There's a few contrary studies saying that it shortens lifespan, but the longest lived people are mostly all on a plant-based whole foods diet. You say, well, but they don't supplement. That doesn't mean we shouldn't supplement. I had on our show Bernardo Lopello, at least a YouTube reply video, and he was talking about salads and preparing fruits and different things. And you get all the protein you need on a whole plant-based foods diet. And he supplements. He was using Dr. Scholl's kind of a whole organic food intake here. I wanted to show you something on the Delgado protocol here. Let's go take a look at the supplements here. Okay, so Slim Blend Protein, which is one of our best-selling products. Really quite impressive, because over the years, it's been one of our best accepted products to get your protein, nitrogen requirements, and essential vitamins, minerals, and amino acids. So do you need it? I would say that it's absolutely not essential. You can get it from the Whole Foods. Why do we include it? Because everyone else out there is selling protein supplements, and they're harmful. I'm going to come on record and say Dairy Whey is highly allergic producing, very toxic and problematic. It's an animal-based protein that's been shown to be highly inflammatory. So I don't like people to use those protein products. So if you're going to use a protein product, use the Slim Blend Protein. It's rich in fiber. It's all organic, 20 whole fruits and vegetables, natural foods. There's a special on it with this show. Just mention you heard about it, and we'll include a code for you there. I'll ask the office today for those people who are interested. But I wanted to kind of conclude with this kind of fun interview, and thanks about the comments that you saw the interview that I did, or the presentation at Dr. John McDougall's show, and that's got, gosh, I think over 100,000 views right now. It keeps growing, and people are excited about just getting the truth and information. So please subscribe, please share, please review. We really appreciate that. And guess what? I'm the one who usually answers the YouTube comments and questions, and because I really enjoy this format of YouTube, and now we're doing live streaming. And if you like it that we're live streaming, please let me know and just click on notification, push notification, so you'll be informed when we do go live. It's a little difficult with my busy schedule to commit to an exact time, and except when we're doing a podcast live webinar. But with you having push notification, you'll get notification like we did just now, go live without announcing it to our general public, except unless you're on our YouTube channel. We have over 1.4 million views now. Subscribers are growing on a daily basis. And please share this channel and look up Dr. Nick Delgado. And you can look up nickdelgado.com. That's nickdelgado.com to connect to all the different offers and opportunities that are coming up. So I hope I dispelled the myths that, along with James Wilkes, with his excellent review of the science and literature. And while he's defending the literature, Joe Rogan is all ears and pretty amazed that his guest, was caught stumbling over several facts that were presented, but agreed with every single thing that James Wilkes said. The Game Changer, please watch it. It's cool. And I'm going to be in March with Arnold Schwarzenegger. I'm going to be at the Conor McGregor fight, Cowboy, here shortly in the January 16th, I think it's coming up, or no, January 18th, Saturday, UFC. My son loves to go to those things. So again, as you see me contracting and my muscles flexing here, it's a pretty intense workout as I experience and do these shows for you. Dr. Nick Delgado, be strong, be well, and please tune in for the next show. And if you're hearing this on iTunes podcasts, please share and review. We'll send you a special gift when you drop me an email note and our contacts information under nickdelgado.com. And that gift this month is NeuroInsight, an amazing methyl donor that's also been known to help DNA protect in regards to 5G exposures. If you like, we can send you a sample of it, a bottle. And in this case, we'll select probably about 10 reviews out of it randomly, and we'll ship those 10 bottles out. And we'll be watching this week for how many people review on iTunes and on YouTube. You do both, you'll get a free bottle valued at approaching $64. Okay, bye-bye, everyone.